So Zephaniah chapter 1, if you're not there, you can go ahead and turn there. And man, I'm excited about this because I've never studied with a group through Zephaniah verse by verse. So for us to be able to open this passage together, look through the words of this prophecy, to me is just absolutely exhilarating. And to have taken over the last several weeks and prayed through Zephaniah and have looked at the things that he says in light of the New Testament and in light of who Jesus is and what he did when he came, to me is just absolutely awesome. And as I was going through it on my own, man, I was filled with the Holy Spirit at points as I was reading it. You know, I experienced the presence of God at points just in thankfulness for how you see Jesus put on display in what was taking place in this generation in which he prophesied. And whenever I see that, whenever I get to see Christ come out of what was going on in history, it fills me with such amazement and thankfulness. Because, man, no man could have put the Word of God together the way that it's put together. No one could have single-handedly masterminded the story that's given to us throughout history in the Bible. It is amazing that you can take more than 40 writers, 39 minimum, put them together throughout 1,500 years of history and find continuity, almost as if the guy who writes three centuries before the guy who will now pick up for us today had a meeting and planned out what they would talk about and did it in such a way to make sure that they would seem connected. And yet they didn't do that. It's connected and there's continuity there because God is God and he's been using different vessels throughout history, but he's the same. He never changes and his plans haven't changed. So the revelation that we have come to us from all these different writers is really from one source, the Holy Spirit of God. Isn't that awesome? So we move from Joel. And we're kind of going to flash forward here because there's a lot of history. Okay, you guys pay real good attention. I don't want to have any distractions because it's going to be easy to miss some of the things that we talk about if you're distracted. And then you're going to be lost 10 minutes from now. So we move from Joel and we go through 160 years of history into the future to come to Zephaniah. So a lot has taken place in Judah. And just a reminder, we're studying only the minor prophets that spoke to Judah because Judah, throughout all ages of the Old Testament, was considered God's people. This is Jerusalem. This is the temple. These are the kings who are in the line of Jesus Christ who would come, the line of Judah. And we're told in the New Testament to listen to what God said to them and to look into the experiences that they had and what God did when they were idolatrous and what God did when they repented, because we're told we can know from that what God is doing in our lives and what he will do if we're idolatrous and what he will do if we turn to him in repentance. We're told to take heed. 1 Corinthians chapter 10 tells us specifically, these things were written down for those of us on whom the end of the ages have come. But 160 years has gone by since Joel prophesied to Judah that the Babylonians were going to come in if they didn't repent and burn down Judah and Jerusalem, destroy the temple, and ultimately that the people would be taken captive. Of course, that event depicting the much further out ultimate day of the Lord that will come at the very end. But this event that would take place, the Babylonian invasion, still has not taken place yet. We're 160 to 175 years further into the future. Sadly, even though by this time there have been some reforms and some miniature revivals, there have also been generations that have taken the nation further into idolatry. And ultimately, we come into Zephaniah's prophecy with them not much better off. And God has decided at this point, not that he didn't know from eternity past, but he's decided at this point to let them know that there's no turning back. There's still the language of hope. There's still the language of, if you repent, what God will do. But these judgments are coming, and there's nothing that anyone can do to stop them. But let's kind of take a look at those 160 years from a bird's eye view real quick. So if you remember, and I know you're probably not going to, and that's okay, so don't feel bad. What king was reigning during Joel's time? Anybody remember? Started out as a little boy, Josh. You're a pastor, but it's okay. Go ahead. Who was it? Okay. Yes. Who just said Joash? Okay, did you read your notes at the top of the Bible? All right. Good job. Good job. That's not cheating. You're allowed to refer to your notes. So it was King Joash, and let's just go through the kings of Judah super quick from one that you will all remember. Everybody remember King Solomon, right? Okay, because the reality is he's David's son, and he's ruling over Israel before it splits in half, as it was in the days of Joash, who was ruling as king when Joel, the last prophet we studied, was prophesying. So here is the kingdom prospering under King Solomon, and King Solomon turns from the Lord, becomes idolatrous, starts to flirt with witchcraft, takes all of these wives and concubines, has multitudes of children, and one of them gets the kingdom handed to him, Rehoboam, and he's a young guy with very little sense. He chooses, instead of listening to the aged advisors that were already there in his father's kingdom, the elders, to listen to his young buddies. And as a result of that, what happens with him is what happens with everyone who turns from the counsel of the aged to the counsel of the young that think they know everything. He breaks the kingdom of God. It splits in half into two kingdoms, the north and the south. And the southern kingdom, who the Bible continues to follow, even after Israel, which the northern kingdom will retain that name, Israel. The southern kingdom is the kingdom the Bible will follow. And this is where Jerusalem is and the temple is. And this is where the kings of Judah reign in the southern kingdom. So Rehoboam breaks the kingdom. He ends up dying in compromise, has a son named Asa who does some good things but some bad things. Asa has a son that you'll remember named Jehoshaphat. Anybody remember Jehoshaphat? He was the king who was basically surrounded by armies, and God just said, hey, this ain't your battle, it's mine. You just stand and praise me and watch what happens. And the enemy destroyed himself. We read about the valley of Jehoshaphat in the book of Joel. How that in the last days, the battle of Armageddon, prophetically speaking, will be as it was in the valley of Jehoshaphat. Where the victory will come not because of God's people fighting with fleshly armaments, but because of our faith. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. But we move from a good king, Jehoshaphat, who unfortunately made some compromises with bad alliances. He allied himself with King Ahab of Israel, who we know was completely wicked, a Baal worshiper, Jezebel's husband. Bad thing to do, to align yourself even with someone who's within Christendom, within the church, the larger body of Christians throughout the earth who's a compromising idol worshiper. Not God's will that we ally ourselves with people that are not really serving the Lord. And Jehoshaphat ends up dying, and his son reigns, Jehoram, who becomes a wicked king, doesn't live like him at all. He's actually killed by the people within his own governmental cabinet. They can't stand him. He brings the nation into idolatry. He has a son, Ahaziah, and Ahaziah rules for only 2 years. And he ends up being killed by the people in his government cabinet. And his mother is a super wicked woman. She's actually a witch named Athaliah. She takes over as queen and for 6 years rules the kingdom of Judah illegitimately as queen mother, as an idolater, as a witch, just like Jezebel did in Israel. And she takes the nation further into its collapse to idolatry. But then comes along Joash, who, as June said, ruled in the days of the prophet Joel. And Joash was hidden by a good priest named Jehoiada, actually taken by Jehoiada's wife and nourished from the time he was a baby, because Athaliah went through to wipe out all of the royal seed so that there wouldn't be a man that would be able to be put upon the throne, and she thought she would secure for herself a long reign. But it didn't work out that way, because when Joash was old enough and Jehoiada the priest had a band of good priests who loved the Lord around him that were strong enough to overthrow her, he moved forward his plot to kill her, and they did. And then they proclaimed Joash to be king. But listen to how sad this gets. Joash reigns for a time, and he is a godly young man. He brings reforms in Israel in the days of Joel the prophet, and he does some great things. But when Jehoiada the priest died, there's no godly influence there that's strong enough to keep a reign on him, and he grows idolatrous. He begins to turn against the Lord, and Jehoiada's son, a priest, Zechariah, rises up, and the Spirit of God comes on him, and he prophesies that because of what Joash is doing, God is going to bring judgment on him. And Joash is now offended, and he has Jehoiada, who raised him. He has Jehoiada's son stoned. He kills him. So as a result of that, he ends up dying. His son Amaziah reigns, the kingdom of God still in idolatry. And during Amaziah's reign, Joel is probably still alive. You also have some unnamed prophets, as you do all through every kingship. Every generation, the Bible tells us, God sent prophets to minister to his people. He always warned a generation that if they didn't turn back from idolatry, judgment was coming. And it always comes to his house first. So then you have, after Amaziah, Joash's son Uzziah. And if you've ever read the book of Isaiah chapter 1, verse 1, Uzziah reigned through the days of Isaiah's prophecy. Isaiah prophesied through the reign of three different kings. Not only Uzziah, but also Jotham, his son. Uzziah was basically a good king, but at the end, he grew prideful. He went into the temple of the Lord and tried to do sacrifices, which was not the job of a king, and God smote him with leprosy, and 80 courageous priests took him and got him out of the temple, and he ended up having to move into a sheltered, isolated home for the rest of his days. Came to repentance, but lived out his days as a leper. His son Jotham did what was right in the sight of the Lord as well, but the people did not turn from their idolatry. Their hearts were still corrupt. Then we came to Ahaz. Ahaz is so wicked, a good king's grandson, that he literally shuts the doors to the temple. He worships false gods and he hates Yahweh so badly that he doesn't want anyone worshiping him. So he stops the feast. He shuts the doors to the temple, and God still sends prophets to him pleading with him, but he will not turn back from this. Now he has a son, Hezekiah. And Hezekiah, most of you'll remember, was a good king. He was a revivalist. He brought in all kind of awesome reforms, and Judah had not seen the kind of reform that took place in his day since the time of David. So he was a mighty man of God, but even he lost his zeal near the end of his life, and in his pride did some silly things and ended up with a nevertheless. I call it a nevertheless because at the end of the description of a reign of a good king, often the writers of Kings and Chronicles will include this phrase, nevertheless, and then they'll describe their compromise. After Hezekiah, you have Manasseh, the most evil king in Judah's history. He's basically a warlock. He consults with mediums and spiritists. He turns the nation full tilt toward idolatry, toward the worship of all kind of false gods. And remember now, this is God's people. This isn't some pagan nation. This is the place where the temple of God is, where God says, I will put my name there. And now the temple in Manasseh's day, both the inner court and the outer court, is filled with idols, filled with statues of false God. The worship of false God is taking place in the churches, so to speak, in Manasseh's reign. And after Manasseh, we have Amon, who is no less a wicked king. And finally, he has a son named Josiah. And we come into the days of Zephaniah the prophet. 160 years of history is what we just went through, of up and down. It's almost like a tug of war. And it seems like Judah is winning the battle to come into repentance and reform and revival, to see the nation turn fully back to the Lord. But the enemy from the other side is always pulling. And see, that's one of the first lessons I think we learn just from the history that spans the length between these two prophets, is we can never in our lives come to a place where we put things on cruise control. And the moment that we do, it may seem to be okay for a little while, like in the days of Hezekiah, but you will find out, if in no other way, through the children that you raise, that putting your Christianity, putting your faith, putting your devotion to God into cruise control always leads to spiritual demise. It always leads to decline. And that is how people wake up one day so far away from God and find themselves saying, how did I get here? Israel is constantly doing the same thing, having to look back 20 years and see, man, we had a revival just 20 years ago. The nation was excited for the things of God, and now the doors to the temple are closed. And it's the same thing individually, where we say, how did I get here? Because when we relax our pursuit of God, we relax our devotion, man, the enemy comes in and he'll do anything he can to make us feel like things are fine, until finally that moment comes, like it did for the prophet, for the judge, Samson, when he thought, just like every other time, I will go out and I will have victory. But on this day, his strength had left him. And sadly, he was taken captive. His eyes were gouged out, and he became a toy and sport for the enemy. And that's what happens with us. But God knows how to hide a godly person, to preserve his kingdom. He'll often put people in places like he did with Joash. The enemy doesn't even know they're there. I mean, he does in a sense, but and he's preserving them because they're going to be a vessel through which he will accomplish his will. And he does that with both Zephaniah, whose name, interestingly, this is the first thing I think we should learn, means Yahweh hides. And the idea is that he preserves, or Yahweh has hidden. So he begins to prophesy, Zephaniah, in the days of Josiah, who we'll learn in 2 Kings is the best king of Israel there ever was. 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 25 will tell us that there was no king like him before him. Yes, that even means David. Why is that? Because the king who is reigning in the days of Zephaniah's prophecy is a type of Jesus Christ. That we have to understand to really get what we're meant to get out of this book. He does what no other king before him and no other king after him would do. That's what the scripture tells us in 2 Kings 23, 25. But let's take a look at the words of this prophecy. Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 1, and I'm going to pull my phone out so I can keep a good track of the time here, because this is an introduction, a necessary one, because I want you to eat, sleep, and breathe what's going on in this generation, because I really believe God has something to say through it. The word of the Lord, which came to Zephaniah, the son of Cushi, the son of Gedaliah, the son of Amariah, the son of Hezekiah, in the days of Josiah, the son of Amon, king of Judah. Very interesting, right off the bat, it seems that he is a descendant of King Hezekiah. That's interesting because Josiah is a great-grandson of Hezekiah. So there is a possibility, theologians, scholars believe, that Zephaniah is actually a cousin of Josiah. And that's interesting to me because in the days of the Lord Jesus, who went before him prophesying? But his cousin, John the Baptist, and the spirit and power of Elijah. And I find Josiah to be such a type of Christ that to me this is no strange thing. That it was perhaps someone he knew, someone who was an older cousin, who was already calling the nation's attention to its need to repent. And man, what is going to happen here is awesome. 25 years from the ending of Zephaniah's prophecy, Jerusalem will be burnt down and destroyed, and the people of God will go into captivity. But what happens here was so good that if there was any chance that God would spare them from this, it would have been during this time. But you see, there is only one person who can spare us from the judgment of God. There's only one person who can see to it that the wrath of a God is averted from us. And that is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, Jesus Christ. Not even Josiah could do for the nation, as great as we're going to see that he was, what only the Messiah, what only the true Son of David would be able to do. Verse 2, I will utterly consume everything from the face of the land. And the word there, land, is ground. And it has to do with the idea that was in the Garden of Eden, the face of the ground from which Adam was taken that he would till. The language here is of total destruction. I will utterly consume everything. It's all going to be burned up. Verse 3, I will consume man and beast. I will consume the birds of the heaven and the fish of the sea. Why pick on the fish? Why? I mean, think about it. There's no way this happened when Nebuchadnezzar came in. The word of God is often prophesying, speaking to us in a literal way. If at some point the fish don't die, this doesn't get fulfilled. Now, do you think when Neb came in that he's like, hey, let's drop some bombs over in the Dead Sea, the Mediterranean. We've got to kill the fish No. Now everything in Jerusalem is all burned up. Why? Because remember, as we go into this, something we learned last time, prophecy is fulfilled in multiple fulfillments. There are always nearby fulfillments. Babylon coming in to bring the day of the Lord in this time, but also the ultimate fulfillment, the day of the Lord to come. And we have to remember that the things that would happen in the near about future only partially bring fulfillment to these prophecies because they were written down. We have Zephaniah for us. That means as we read this, though he was a prophet to Judah, understand he's your prophet. He is a prophet to us. He is prophesying to the people of God in every generation. And if we lose that, we'll study this like it's a piece of history instead of something that God wants to say to us right now. But why the fish? I mean, think about that. I will consume man and beast, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, the stumbling blocks, which that in the Hebrew is idols, along with the wicked people who follow idols, serve idols, worship idols. I will cut off from the face of the ground, that's the word there, says the Lord. I'm going to cut everything off. I'm going to totally consume, totally destroy. Can you imagine? I'm looking at Heather, and it was funny because I'm just thinking, Adam, I wish he was here. Like, there's a day coming when all the fish, I mean, they're going to put you out of business. The day of the Lord is no joke here. You'll have to share that with him. Like, Adam, have you read Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 3? You need to be prepared. The fish are going away. Can share that with Matt, you know, all of us guys that love to fish. But it's total destruction. We have to look. Turn with me at 2 Peter because we have to have the New Testament, the modern context to this that the Lord would have us to. 2 Peter, I think, is just a good reminder that though destruction is coming on this entire world in the time of God's wrath, the Bible is very clear where judgment begins. It begins where it always begins, and it will begin in the future where it always has begun. First Peter, or actually go to 2 Peter chapter 3 and pick it up with me. No, I think I may have gotten that right for once. 1 Peter, 2 Peter, when you're in the middle of teaching, mixing things up becomes so easy to do. So let me just make sure we're in the right place here. Okay, total destruction. 2 Peter chapter 3, begin with me in verse 8. But beloved, don't forget this one thing, that with the Lord one day is as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years as one day. The Lord isn't slack concerning his promises. Some count slackness, but he's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord, and that is what Zephaniah is speaking to us about. In fact, one of the key verses there, if you want to mark it, is verse 7, when he introduces that, yes, what I'm talking about is the day of the Lord. But the day of the Lord, 2 Peter 3:10, will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Everything will be consumed, both the earth and the works that are in it, and that would include the fish, and everything will be burned up. And then to us an exhortation, therefore, since all these things will be dissolved, what manner of people ought you to be in holy living and godliness, looking for and hastening the coming day of God, because of which the heavens will be dissolved, being on fire, and the elements will melt with fervent heat. Everything's going to be destroyed. But I want you to know how specific prophecy is. Why add the fish in there? Because they're going to be destroyed. You see, when the time of the Lord grows near, there is this period we call the tribulation. And during some time before the middle of that period comes, there is going to be a world war that outdoes anything prior to it in history. And it's going to seem like it's the end. And if it weren't for the Lord stepping in, it certainly would be. But even the atrocities and the terrible things going on in that time don't hold a candle to what is ultimately still to come. In the Revelation, you have seven seals, seven trumpets, and seven bowls of God's wrath. Those bowls of God's wrath are said to hold the undiluted wrath of God. And in that day, this prophecy we're reading will be fully fulfilled. Every fish on this planet, I believe, without exception, except for maybe some small spring the Lord preserved somewhere for His people in that day that were said, that are said to still be on the planet, some of them. All of them will be dead. They will die. I want you to see this specifically. Revelation chapter 8, seven angels blowing seven trumpets, or more particularly, more specifically, seven messengers blowing seven trumpets. And in Revelation chapter 8, verse 8, look at what takes place at the second trumpet. Verse 8 says, "Then the second angel sounded, and something like a great mountain burning with fire." We read through some of these verses in our closing of Joel. "Like a great mountain burning with fire was thrown into the sea, and the third of the sea became blood, and a third of the living creatures in the sea died." This is really going to happen, just like Zephaniah says. A third of the living creatures in the sea died. A third of the ships were destroyed. This is war. That's why ships are destroyed. And then the third angel sounded, a great star fell from heaven, burning like a torch, and it fell on the third of the rivers and the springs of water. This is what's called prophetically wormwood. It makes them bitter. Men die because of this. You guys have seen red tide. You know what happens when the waters are affected. The fish end up dying first, and that's usually the sign, don't drink that. That's not good stuff. But God is not yet done. Because while this is man's doing, we know from Revelation chapter 11 and 12, where the Lord says, "I will destroy those who are destroying the earth," God's wrath is still to come in its complete form. Look with me at Revelation chapter 16, over a few pages, when the bowls of His wrath are being poured out. Revelation chapter 16 in verse 3, "Then the same angel," the second angel, "poured out his bowl on the sea, and it became blood as of a dead man, and every living creature in the sea died." When the second angel pours out the second bowl of God's wrath, what we're reading right now in Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 3, it will be fulfilled. The Bible actually says here in Isaiah, we don't have to turn there, but it says in Isaiah something similar to what it says here. It says that He will make mortal men more rare in the day of the Lord than the gold of Ophir. The gold of Ophir was the rarest, most fine, and most pure gold in the day of Solomon, that became after his reign almost invisible to man's knowledge. There doesn't seem to be anything but the scarcest mentions of it. And God says that He will make man like that. So many people are going to die during this time. And if you were to read Revelation chapter 16, you'll find something horrible there. That even though God, in this final attempt, is giving man everything he needs to see that he's come to his ruin and to repent, the Bible tells us there in Revelation 16 that man still would not repent of his idolatries and the worship of gold and silver and demons and idols. And what is happening here with God's people? They've turned to this. It's why we get the language in Revelation 17 and 18 speaking of Babylon. Come out of her, my people, and be not partakers of her plagues, sharing in her sins. If you share in the sins of the world, even though you identify as a child of God, you will partake of the plagues of God's wrath and the judgment of sin. Because the church is no different than the people of God in the old time. It is filled with wheat and tares. And this is why the Bible tells us we're to make our calling and our election sure, to examine ourselves to see whether we're in the faith. We're not to take a lackadaisical approach to our faith, to stop pursuing God, to set aside our devotion, because the ability to do that often indicates that one is not actually born again. And we need to know, and we need to strive to enter into the rest. We don't become born again as a result of works. It's by faith alone, by grace alone. But that faith, that grace is so transformative. It changes our lives. And if we walk away and we begin to decline, God is faithful and judgment will come upon us. Turn with me now to 1 Peter chapter 4. And keep your finger in Zephaniah, because we are going to read the next set of verses. But I want you to see it in direct context with 1 Peter chapter 4. Our generation, probably more than any other, has lost sight of this truth that we desperately must understand as we continue on into the future and see decline, spiritual decline in the church. And I don't mean decline in attendance, though in good churches that does often happen. I mean spiritual decline, often in cases where numbers are blossoming and churches are seemingly growing and amassing funds and buildings, and yet still very much, if the heart was known, like the church of Laodicea, very rich, prospering, so many different aspects of ministry, it would seem, and yet Jesus is on the outside trying to get in. Zephaniah chapter 1, the next couple of verses with your finger in 1 Peter 4. Verse 4, he brings it home. I will stretch out my hand against Judah. Now he's beginning to prophesy against his people. He's being clear. This is going to start with us, guys. And all the inhabitants of Jerusalem, I'm bringing it home. Saying the same thing Joel was saying. I will cut off every trace of Baal from this place. The names of the idolatrous priest and the pagan priest. Because the priest in this day, some of them had turned aside. They were idol worshipers at heart. And then there were some of them that were just totally pagan. Those who worship, verse 5, the host of heaven on the housetops, and those who worship and swear oaths by the Lord, but who also swear by Milcom. They're still Christians. They're still Jews. They still identify that way. But they're trying to worship God and live the way the world does, worshiping idols. Those who have turned back from following the Lord. There was a time when they did seemingly follow the Lord. They've turned back from it, and they've not sought the Lord nor inquired of him. 1 Peter 4 tells us judgment must begin at the house of the Lord. Take a look with me, beginning in verse 12, 1 Peter. I'm in 2 Peter again. Had it backwards last time, got it backwards again. 1 Peter 4, beloved, don't think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you as though some strange thing happened to you. Start there just for a minute. The Christian life is hard because it's meant to be hard. Because difficulty, unfortunately, is often the only thing that will keep us on our knees. And it comes off strange sometimes. I just asked the Lord recently, come on, Lord, why everything was going great. I've been praying, and then something happens and puts me on my knees. I'd rather go to my knees on my own, but I've made a covenant with the Lord that if I won't, that he would put me there. And if he has to do something in my life to make that happen, that just says that he's a good God who's faithful when I grow laxed to allow things into my life to put me in that place where I've asked to be put. And this is what God has always done with his people, and it's what he'll do with us. Don't think it's strange, because if you're his, you ask for these things. And while God is never pleased that we would suffer, we will suffer. He says, verse 15, let none of you suffer as a murderer, thief, evildoer, or busybody in other people's matters. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, don't be ashamed of it. Let him glorify God in this matter. For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God. And the Greek reads this way. You'll notice in the King James, New King James, has come is italicized. It just reads present continuing. The time is here, or the time is coming. It's present continuous for judgment to begin at the house of God. And if with us first, what will the end of those be who do not obey the gospel of God? Back to Zephaniah. It begins with us. It always has. Peter, a New Testament apostle who stood up on the day of Pentecost and preached to the tune of 3,000 salvations, is the one who tells us judgment begins at the house of the Lord. It always has. And that's what we're reading about. But look at this. Verse 4, the end of the verse says, I'm going to cut off every trace of Baal from this place. You know what Josiah did? You can read it for homework. But in 2 Kings 22 and 23, if you can read those, they're majestic. They're awesome. He's 8 years old for 10 years because he's being trained to love the Lord. And he does love the Lord. God's moving in his heart. He just has the priests moving to get the temple repaired. It's in disrepair. It had been shut down. It's full of junk. You know what? They don't even have the Bible. Because under Manasseh and Amon, the Bible was taken away by wicked priests, hidden, no longer spoke, no longer taught, read. They didn't have the Bible. The priests didn't have it. So as they're doing what Josiah has them doing between him being 8 and 18 years old, they find the Bible, 2 Kings chapter 22, and they bring it, and they read it, and he just flips out. He rips his clothes, and he loves the Lord. He's already doing what's right as best as he knows, but when he has the revelation of God's word, when he understands, oh, wait, this is how it's supposed to be, not like this. We're doing pretty good, but this is still not how it's supposed to be. He flips out, and he puts his boots on and goes to work, and he tears down every high place. He tears down every idol. He ruins idol worship. He cuts off every trace of Baal. Literally, he kills idolatrous priests, pagan priests. There is no idol worship, none, in the kingdom of God in his day. And many people believe it was partly because of Zephaniah's prophecy, because Zephaniah is prophesying in a day when a guy can't even open the Bible and check it out. And now they get that back, and they know what's coming, and Josiah's like, we have to do something by the grace of God about this. And he goes to work bringing reforms, and he holds a Passover, the largest of which has ever been held in history. Nothing like him before or after him. He is a picture of Jesus Christ. And as we close this, because I just want us to be able to worship the Lord just with a song, I'm going to have Tiffany and Heather come up and lead us in a song. But I want to close it with this awesome thought. Verse 7, be silent in the presence of the Lord God, for the day of the Lord is at hand. The Lord has prepared a sacrifice and invited his guest, and it will be in the day of the Lord's sacrifice that I will punish the princes and the king's children and all such who are clothed with foreign apparel. There is something that Josiah could not do for his people that only Jesus could. His death is an anomaly. It makes no sense. If you study his life, he's serving the Lord. He's awesome. Man, I love this guy. This guy set my heart aflame before I ever preached a message in my life. I cherished the record of this young man's life, and I thought, I want to be like this young man. And in fact, it was a message that I got to share that an old pastor, Pastor Vivian Laird, invited me to share almost by mistake in men's breakfast 15 or 16 years ago or something like that. That was the first message I ever shared with a group of people. And it was that message that was taken to my pastor that would later ordain me as a pastor that began everything. This man is significant to me, but there was one thing he couldn't do. And I never understood this, but I understand it now. Pharaoh Necho, who was very strong in his day, was going out to battle, and Josiah, who was inconquerable, he was a bad man. He went out to approach Pharaoh Necho, and a strange thing happened. Pharaoh Necho said to him, go back. Don't do this because your God sent me to do what I'm doing. Wasn't coming against Judah. He had grown so used to victory, but he came to a moment. The Lord doesn't tell us he compromised at all, but he got this one wrong. He evidently thought it was right. We get it wrong sometimes. Pharaoh Necho killed him, and then the story is over. He was defeated by the Egyptian army. You see, there's one thing that Josiah could not do for the people of God that only Jesus can. Egypt is a picture of the world, and Pharaoh has always been a picture of sin and Satan. Only Jesus Christ overcomes the world. In this world, you'll have trouble, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And we're going to get to read in later weeks, Revelation 19, where he comes in, puts his foot on the neck of the enemy, and has his name declared to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Josiah's king, the one who could do what no other can. Man, Jesus Christ is so awesome. Would you stand with me if you're able? If you're not, that's okay. And let's just close by giving the Lord one song of worship. I think it would be appropriate if we'll hold any questions from today for next week. Man, he is so worthy. Let's just worship him for just a song. Praise God.